partners with a new consciousness, troubled. They did not speak for some time, but sat, hand fast, with averted, shining faces. And every now and then the car swung her against him, and they waited for the motion to bring them together. Yet they stared out of the windows, mute. She saw the familiar country racing by, but now it was no familiar country, it was Wonderland. There was the hemlock stone, standing on its grassy hill. Strange it looked on this wet, early summer evening, remote, in a magic land. Some rooks were flying out of the trees. Ah, if only she and Skrebensky could get out, dismount into this enchanted land where nobody had ever been before. Then they would be enchanted people. They would put off the dull, customary self. If she were wandering there, on that hill slope, under a silvery, changing sky, in which many rooks melted like hurrying showers of blots, if they could walk past the wetted hay swaths, smelling the early evening, and pass into the wood, where the honeysuckle scent was sweet on the cold tang in the air, and showers of drops fell when one brushed a bough, cold and lovely on the face. But she was here with him in the car, close to him, and the wind was rushing on her lifted, eager face, blowing back the hair. He turned and looked at her face clean as a chiselled thing, her hair chiselled back by the wind, her fine nose keen and lifted. It was agony to him, seeing her swift and clean-cut and virgin. He wanted to kill himself and throw his detested carcass at her feet. His desire to turn round on himself and rend himself was an agony to him. Suddenly she glanced at him. He seemed to be crouching towards her, reaching. He seemed to wince between the brow. His expression changed. His old reckless laugh shone to her. She pressed his hand in utter delight, and he abided. And suddenly she stooped and kissed his hand, bent her head and caught it to her mouth in generous homage. And the blood burned in him. Yet he remained still. He made no move. She started. They were swinging into Kosciuszko. Skrebensky was going to leave her. But it was all so magic. Her cup was so full of bright wine. Her eyes could only shine. He tapped and spoke to the man. The car swung up by the yew trees. She gave him her hand and said goodbye, naive and brief as a schoolgirl. And she stood watching him go, her face shining. The fact of his driving on meant nothing to her. She was so filled by her own bright ecstasy. She did not see him go, for she was filled with light, which was of him. Bright with an amazing light as she was, how could she miss him? Could she miss him? In her bedroom she threw her arms in the air in clear pain of magnificence. Oh, it was her transfiguration. She was beyond herself. She wanted to fling herself into all the hidden brightness of the air. It was there, it was there, if she could but meet it. But the next day she knew he had gone. Her glory had partly died down, but never from her memory. It was too real. Yet it was gone by, leaving a wistfulness. A deeper yearning came into her soul, a new reserve. She shrank from touch and question. She was very proud, but very new and very sensitive. Oh, that no one should lay hands on her! She was happier running on by herself. Oh, it was a joy to run along the lanes without seeing things, yet being with them. It was such a joy to be alone with all one's riches. The holidays came, when she was free. She spent most of her time she was free. She spent most of her time running on by herself, curled up in a squirrel place in the garden, lying in a hammock in the coppice, while the birds came near, near, so near. Oh, in rainy weather she flitted to the marsh and lay hidden with her book in a hayloft. All the time she dreamed of him, sometimes definitely, but when she was happiest, only vaguely. He was the warm colouring of her dreams. He was the hot blood beating within them. When she was less happy, out of sorts, she pondered over his appearance, his clothes, the buttons with his regimental badge, which he had given her. Or she tried to imagine his life in barracks. Or she conjured up a vision of herself as she appeared in his eyes. His birthday was in August, and she spent some pains on making him a cake. She felt that it would not be in good taste for her to give him a present. Their correspondence was brief, mostly an exchange of postcards, not at all frequent. But with her cake she must send him a letter. "Dear Anton, the sunshine has come back specially for your birthday, I think. I made the cake myself and wish you many happy returns of the day. Don't eat it if it is not good. Mother hopes you will come and see us when you are near enough. I am, your sincere friend, Ursula Brangwen." It bored her to write a letter, even to him. After all, writing words on paper had nothing to do with him and her. The fine weather had set in. The cutting machine went on from dawn till sunset, chattering round the fields. She heard from Skrebensky. He too was on duty in the country, on Salisbury Plain. He was now a second lieutenant in a field troop. He would have a few days off shortly, and would come to the marsh for the wedding. Fred Brangwen was going to marry a schoolmistress out of Ilkeston as soon as corn harvest was at an end. The dim blue and gold of a hot, sweet autumn saw the close of the corn harvest. To Ursula it was as if the world had opened its softest, purest flower, its chicory flower, its meadow saffron. The sky was blue and sweet. The yellow leaves down the lane seemed like free, wandering flowers as they chittered round the feet, making a keen, poignant, almost unbearable music to her heart. And the scents of autumn were like a summer madness to her. She fled away from the little purple-red button chrysanthemums like a frightened dryad. The bright yellow little chrysanthemums smelled so strong. Her feet seemed to dither in a drunken dance. Then her Uncle Tom appeared, always like the cynical Bacchus in the picture. He would have a jolly wedding, a harvest supper and a wedding feast in one, a tent in the home close, and a band for dancing, and a great feast out of doors. Fred demurred, but Tom must be sat. Also, Laura, a handsome, clever girl, the bride, she also must have a great and jolly feast. It appealed to her educated sense. She had been to Salisbury Training College, knew folk songs and Morris dancing. So the preparations were begun, directed by Tom Brangwen. A marquee was set up on the home close. Two large bonfires were prepared. Musicians were hired. Feast made ready. Skrebensky was to come, arriving in the morning. Ursula had a new white dress of soft crepe and a white hat. She liked to wear white. With her black hair and clear golden skin, she looked southern, or rather tropical, like a Creole. She wore no colour whatsoever. She trembled that day as she appeared to go down to the wedding. She was to be a bridesmaid. Skrebensky would not arrive till afternoon. The wedding was at 2 o'clock. As the wedding party returned home, Skrebensky stood in the parlour at the marsh. Through the window he saw Tom Brangwen, who was best man, coming up the garden path, most elegant in cutaway coat and white slip and spats, with Ursula laughing on his arm. Tom Brangwen was handsome, with his womanish colouring and dark eyes and black close-cut moustache. But there was something subtly coarse and suggestive about him for all his beauty, his strange, bestial nostrils, open so hard and wide, and his well-shaped head almost disquieting in its nakedness, rather bald from the front, and all its soft fullness betrayed. Skrebensky saw the man rather than the woman. She saw only the slender, unchangeable youth waiting there, inscrutable, like her fate. He was beyond her, with his loose, slightly horsey appearance that made him seem very manly and foreign. Yet his face was smooth and soft and impressionable. She shook hands with him, and her voice was like the rousing of a bird startled by the dawn. "Isn't it nice," she cried, "to have a wedding?" There were bits of coloured confetti lodged on her dark hair. Again the confusion came over him, as if he were losing himself and becoming all vague, undefined, inchoate. Yet he wanted to be hard, manly, horsey, and he followed her. There was a light tea, and the guests scattered. The real feast was for the evening. Ursula walked out with Skrebensky through the stackyard to the fields, and up the embankment to the canal side. The new corn stacks were big and golden as they went by. An army of white geese marched aside in braggart protest. Ursula was light as a white ball of down. Skrebensky drifted beside her, indefinite. His old form loosened, and another self, grey, vague, drifting out as from a bud. They talked lightly of nothing. The blue way of the canal wound softly between the autumn hedges, on towards the greenness of a small hill. On the left was the whole black agitation of colliery and railway, and the town which rose on its hill, the church tower topping all. The round white dot of the clock on the tower was distinct in the evening light. That way, Ursula felt, was the way to London, through the grim, alluring seethe of the town. On the other hand was the evening, mellow over the green water meadows and the winding alder trees beside the river, and the pale stretches of stubble beyond. There the evening glowed softly, and even a peewit was flapping in solitude and peace. Ursula and Anton Skrebensky walked along the ridge of the canal between. The berries on the hedges were crimson and bright red above the leaves. The glow of evening and the wheeling of the solitary peewit and the faint cry of the birds came to meet the shuffling noise of the pits, the dark fuming stress of the town opposite, and they too walked the blue strip of waterway, the ribbon of sky between. He was looking, Ursula thought, very beautiful, because of a flush of sunburn on his hands and face. He was telling